Valeo and one of the biggest challenges in the automotive industry. It's one of the famous words of our chief executive officer, CEO of Valeo, Jashin Imbrah, that he mentioned explicitly that there are three main challenges in the automotive industry currently are running. The first one is the electrification, and the second one is the advanced driving assistance systems or the autonomous vehicles, how the vehicle will move autonomously. And the third one, which is the digital mobility, which I will try also to touch in during my presentation, and we'll try to speak about it. It's highly related to the advanced driving assistance systems. So briefly about myself, my name is Mohamed Radwan. I have an experience in both the silicon industry, mainly in mentor graphics for about 4 years. And I joined Valeo in 2016. I have also worked in the academic research for 2 years. Actually, I have my bachelor, master's, and PhD in computer and systems engineering from Enchamps University. Since I joined Valeo, I have recently been promoted as a Valeo top innovator and top maker with more than two proof of concepts and three P3 developments that's led to four product adoptions and about 20 patent proposals and a lot of publications. I have nine granted patents in the previous year. These are all since these 4 years or 5 years since my joining to Valeo. And actually this journey of success is coherent with my the effort done with my colleges. So finally, in 2019, I was officially promoted as a Valeo senior expert in systems engineering related to the advanced driving assistance systems, which is the main draw topic I will try to speak about it with you. The three main objectives from the meeting is to speak to you about the self-driving cars, how this technology is realized in Valeo, what's its challenges, and how you can be prepared to have a part to take your place in this challenge. So I will try to speak briefly about Valeo and our challenges in the driving assistance systems and the products which we are delivering in Valeo Egypt, which was one of the biggest R&D sites in Valeo worldwide. And then I will try to capture one of our samples of success, which is the parking solutions, which I was honored to be working in its deliveries for almost all of my period during Valeo. And then I will keep touch for the connected vehicles. The connected vehicles is one of the very challenging parts, especially for digital mobility. And I already have some researches in this field. Then at the end, I will try to draw a roadmap for you as students, as an engineers, how to be a qualified engineer to join Valeo. And this should be accompanied with some main messages. So if I try to speak about Valeo, I think that when I speak about automotive, many of you don't know Valeo, don't know Continental, don't know Bosch, don't know Aptiv. You are the most famous are the car makers, the original equipment manufacturers like Daimler, like Renault, like BMW, like Volkswagen, Toyota. And actually, Valeo, like other tier one suppliers, which I mentioned, Continental, Bosch, or Aptiv, ZF, they play a very important role in this automotive chain, because the suppliers, as I mentioned here, represent more than 70% of the car's added value for the different functionalities of the vehicle. So it's very important for the suppliers to highlight their role, the components, the closed systems and the modules delivered in the directly and the plug and play inside the car it grants the vehicle more than 70% of its value. So Valeo plays two main roles in the automotive chain. One of them is to act as a tier one supplier, which supplies the car manufacturers directly with important hardware, software, mechanical components, or a component that's integrated as a black box containing different parts coherently, and also has another role, which is the value service aftermarket, to provide the services for the garages or the car stores for the different car parts. So really, we have more than 100,000 employees over the world, more than 60 research and development centers, and one of the biggest research and development centers for Valeo worldwide, and is something actually all of us proud of it. It's really the Cairo site. And Valeo is spread over about 33 countries with more than 15 distribution platforms and 107 product sites. So Valeo is divided into a group of business groups. Each business group is related to a specific product or a specific service. For example, we have four or five major business groups. One of them is comfort driving assistance, which I belongs to, where we are delivering all the functionalities from the sensors, from the software components and hardware components related to the driving assistance systems and the interior controls, like the interior camera that's for vision system for the passengers, and the exterior sensors, which I will speak more explicitly about them. And also we have another business groups related to the wiper and the lighting systems, and the both lighting in the external and the internal lightings, and the power training systems for related with the electrification of the vehicle's motor, and also the thermal systems for the adaptation for the temperature of the vehicle, and the climate control, and also the Valeo service, which is considered one of the business groups. So all the business groups are coherent to the automotive industry, and one of the biggest these business groups is the driving assistance systems, which is in the comfort and driving assistance business group. Yeah, and this is a part of the different OEMs or original equipment manufacturers or car makers in the worldwide, in different regions, in Europe, in Asia, in US. And I think all of you are greatly familiar with these names, which we are all working directly with them in different projects. The R&D is the core for our products. Innovations, which we are delivering, as I mentioned at the beginning, that I am honored to be a top innovator in Valeo with about 20 patent proposals and several publications. Our patent is our protection for our IP, for our intellectual property. Innovations present more than 30% of the added values for a product which we are delivering. So as I mentioned here, 35% of our order intake involves our innovations, which present really our future, how we can bring our product to the market, and how it can be sold, and how it can be attractive to the customers, either in the different demos we are presenting to it. So the patents and the innovations is one of our major core products, which represents presented in our research and development centers. And actually, from 10,000 people, now in Valeo Egypt, we are almost reaching 2,000, which is about 1/5%, 20% of the whole percentage of the R&D employees worldwide, which is something really I'm proud of it. Okay, let's speak about the autonomous driving assistance, how it's first, how it's needed. Is it something mandatory, or it's something fancy, or something for marketing? Many of the reports, as you see, show greatly that a lot of the car crashes are related to the human faults, either from the human faults themselves, as you mentioned here by, for example, the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration of the US, which is a recent report, and a lot of other references that mention this high percentage of driver faults. And also the causes are related mostly either for this driver recognition or decision faults. And that's why there is a great demand, not just for marketing, not just for being the vehicle attractive, not just making the driving more easier, but it's now a must that, like, for example, the Euro NCAP, the car assessment programs in Europe and US and in Asia has made a trying to make a lot of regulations to be sure that the vehicles will be produced with enough safety automated systems. So let me show you this short video about our demo for the CrossFlew or the hands-free tour, which is one of our initial autonomous driving demos for Valeo, which is about 5 years ago, I think, which is one of our initial demos to investigate or to show how the autonomous driving is working. So yes, I see the video. Okay, I'll try to play. So this video show a long trip for about 1 month. That's the vehicle was making autonomous travels in different roads across the US. The vehicle is a VW vehicle that's equipped with a laser sensor and front camera and radar cocoon, which means that the radar sensors are across the four corners of the vehicle and the GPS for localization. I'm sorry for the interruptions of bandwidth. Yeah. Just decrease its quality. So I will okay till it's loaded. Give it some time to be loaded first. I'm sorry for this interruption. So I just want to reveal in this video how, for some basic functionality maneuvers in the automated driving at highways, the vehicle is acting smoothly and safely for lane changing, for jam assisting, for cruise control. That's the basic functionalities, also for the emergency braking, as we will show during this video, for the basic functionalities for the automated driving at highways. This is the SCALA sensor, which is the LiDAR or laser sensor, which is used. And this is an example for the lane changing assistance. Okay, I will stop the vehicle, stop the video till be fully loaded. If it stopped again, I will try to continue the slides again, and if I have time, I will return back to it till it be loaded in a better way. So. Okay, then these are the well-known five levels of driving automation that it's targeted to be accomplished by the different OEMs or the different car manufacturers. There are basic six categories, which is published or emphasized by the Society of Automotive Engineers and the Network for Mobility Electronics. So the level zero is manual driving, which is something that we can see there is no automation at all. And the level one, which is driver assistance, means that at least one function is controlled automatically. Like for example, as we showed here, right? For example, the cruise control, there is one full functionality controlled automatically. For example, for the cruise control, as you some of you know already, that the vehicle is controlled longitudinally. The vehicle controls the acceleration and deceleration actions so that the vehicle can follow a specific object or track a specific object moving in front of the vehicle. So that with these actions, the vehicle can be settled to a specific speed according to the vehicle tracked in front of the vehicle. So it's something of like a longitudinal only control, controlling only the acceleration and deceleration actions. For the partial automation, which is level two, means that both the steering, the lateral control, and the acceleration deceleration are fully automated with the driver. Are fully automated and with the driver ready only to take the control. So the system is fully automating both the steering and the acceleration deceleration parts. And for the conditional automation one, all the safety critical functions are fully controlled, but under specific conditions. In order to show you what are these differences, because it may be not clear, I will take an example for the parking, and I will show you some videos for the parking, which reveals how these levels of automation are realized. And for level four, it means that all safety controls are fully automated in all conditions, as if you are moving from a full trip from a place to a place, and the vehicle is fully automated without any interaction from the driver. Level five is like level four, but not for only one trip. But it can be forever. There is no seat for a driver. Robotaxis, for example, is one of the examples that Tesla was highlighting. It will be generated or to be under production since the previous year. Before the COVID-19 situation, I think Tesla was about to, in April 2020, was about to provide the market with the first robotaxis. Also, I think the Waymo was in the same direction. Many of the new American companies and also the German one are moving greatly in this direction. Actually, one of the very important topics that I want to declare here in the automotive, that the market is now very open. It's not only closed for the automotive well-known manufacturers, but even the silicon industry companies are moving in a very good steps. As you see now, NVIDIA is working in automotive, NXP is working in automotive. Qualcomm is working in automotive, Samsung, Siemens, Synopsys even. So there is, for example, a very well-known cooperation between NVIDIA and Daimler in the other neural solutions of Mercedes. So it's clear that the autonomous driving is now not dedicated only for software companies, but also for software, for silicon, and for hardware or the mechanical manufacturers and the original equipment manufacturers. So in order to deliver an autonomous driving system, you need to make a system that can well understand the environment. And before understanding and sensing the environment changes, you need to well understand the human driving behavior. What should be the normal human driving behavior, and how the human should interact with the different situations in order to have a system that can fully mimic the human interactions and the human behavior. And this is, should be accompanied with a powerful algorithms and functions that can be running on a low target and sure to have a full control for the vehicle to accomplish these functionalities and to provide the user with significant feedback through, like, for example, the human machine interfaces. So I can briefly mention that the autonomous driving has three main challenges. One of them, or the most important one of them, is the environment sensing or the perception. The second one is the behavioral decision or the motion planning. And the third one is how to make the control of the vehicle to achieve this targeted behavior or motion plan. So the first challenge, which is the environment sensing, is basically how we can percept our environment. And as you see in this picture, there's some sample of sensors that we are manufacturing in Valeo for the different ranges targeted for the different functionalities. So the ultrasonic sensor, for example, which is a very well-known sensor that is, as you see now, in almost all the new vehicles, is very important for the short-range detections, which is important, for example, as you will see, for the parking solutions. Also, it's accompanied with a full surrounding vision system for 4 or 5 or even 6 cameras, and that's the side of a front camera at the upper roof of the vehicle, which is important for the front detection, especially for the high speed applications. The ultrasonic sensors, as you see at the right bottom, and at the left bottom you see the vision sensors and the radar sensors, which is important for the detections at different ranges, especially for the lane changing, for the blind spot detections at different ranges. And the radar sensors has, as we are delivering in Valeo, has, as we mentioned, some at short ranges, some at mid ranges, some at higher ranges. And also the fourth one, which is one of our super sensors, that's Valeo, has a unique impact in the market. That's Valeo is the first company in the market that's delivering a full laser sensor, which is called the SCALA sensor. That's basically, it's very important for accomplishing the level 5 or the level 4 of the autonomous driving, for its high accuracy and for its high ranging of detection. So it has another challenges. That's why all the market now are fighting for who will get the first solid state LiDAR sensor, and I think it could be accomplished soon. Especially that the competition is very high for these sensors specifically. So as I can see, we can see here again that for every category of sensors, we have a category of specific functionalities that's either related to the low speed maneuver systems, like the parking, and the small distances maneuvers to avoid some obstacles like the traffic jam assist, and for the high speed applications like the lane change assist, like the lane keeping assist, like the adaptive cruise control, like the emergency braking, and all of them are accompanied with the specific sensors for specific ranges to accomplish these functionalities. And for all of them, sure, there should be an intuitive human-machine interfacing to the customer or to the user or to the driver to show him how is the different functionalities. So in this slide, yes, it's clear now what should be the main architecture for the autonomous driving system. So as you see here in the blue, you can see that this our input sensors, our radio sensors or signal radio sensors, or the inertial sensors, the inertial measurement unit to locate or to measure the motion of the vehicle, like the GPS to localize the vehicle and to determine how the vehicle is moving in this environment, beside the radio sensors in order to, by the end, to make a full mapping and localization for the vehicle to determine exactly how the objects are surrounding the vehicle are located. Even these objects could be static objects, even these objects could be dynamic objects, how the vehicle are moving, or how can I estimate their paths or their trajectories in the future, how can I estimate the motion or the predicted motion of my own vehicle, what we call the ego vehicle, how my ego vehicle is moving in the environment, how its paths will be in the future. Is there a probable collision with other objects? How I localize myself in a specific area or a specific region based on my speeds? Also, how to locate in a continuous way the different objects with respect to the ego vehicle. That's what we call localization and mapping techniques. And this is sure based on excessive mathematical approaches. That's very important for an engineer working in ADAS to be aware of it. After this green and the blue parts, and we have accomplished the map and located the vehicle, we need to plan how the vehicle or how the ego vehicle should move, should interact, should behave in this environment. I mean, for example, if I am making a parking, how I can plan a motion, safe motion, and efficient motion for the vehicle to park. Shall I plan one step or shall I plan several steps? Can I park in less than, for example, 3 or 4 steps? Can I plan more than this? Can I plan less than this? Can I park in less steps than this, so that the passenger or the user feel that the vehicle has made a super planning or super motion, that it parks safely in one shot, for example? And after accomplishing this planning, how I can guarantee that the vehicle will safely and accurately follow this planned trajectory? That's what we accomplish in the final block of the vehicle control. So, as I mentioned, just to briefly summarize the major points from the major challenges we have in the advanced driving assistance systems, we have 3 major challenges, which is the environment sensing or the perception, and should this accompanied by the mapping and localization of the vehicle. Second, what should be the perfect behavior of the vehicle, that the vehicle should behave? What's the best motion planning approach that the path should the vehicle should follow to accomplish the specific target? And third, how the vehicle can be efficiently controlled to follow this path. So then, if I look briefly about examples of some of our products in this in this challenging market, I can say that, as you see, the SCALA sensor and the vision systems and the cross for you, the park for you, the drive for you, all of these are different products that we are fully accomplishing and making its design and development and integration and the validation phases in Valeo and specifically in Valeo Egypt. As you see here, this is the picture at the left. This is the radar sensor, which is used basically for the lane change systems. The one in the middle is the front camera sensor, and all the front camera ECU. And the third one on the right is the ultrasonic sensor. So this is a sample of also of the different products or the different functionalities that's delivered by our sensors. And all of them are, if every sensor of them can be called, what we call is a smart sensor, that it has a full driver and control software that's running on it and interacting with a master ECU, where we have a full control or the full algorithm for the other functionalities of the sensor of the driving assistance systems. And now this even architecture is becoming more complex as we are going to a more integrated systems, where there is a lot, can be a huge chip where all the software for the different functionalities is running in one big ECU, in one big control unit. That's actually this is that the market is very challenging in this part. And actually, I will try also to speak about this part of the continuous integration and the software complexity parts, and how this, the testing, the challenge for testing of these huge software products in the next part of the slides. Okay. And also, it's important also to know that the importance of the software used in the real-time operating systems that we are using, for example, the AUTOSAR or adaptive AUTOSAR, or even the embedded Linux, which is one of the very important topics for the engineers to be aware of it or to practice it specifically in their graduation projects, as I will mention afterwards. Okay, just to give you a sample in order to make you feel about how these challenges we have in the parking systems, I will show you this group of videos about the park for you, the park for you solutions we have in Valeo, and how it's this innovation started more than 10 years ago with our initial products of hands-free parking. I think this video is more than 10 years old. And this is also one of our very initial solutions for the hand-free parking, where the vehicle is making just the lateral motion or the lateral control, the lateral steering, and the driver is making the longitudinal control. This is like, we can say that's a sample of, we can say, level one automation, which we can call the driver assistance systems. We hear that the vehicle is making, the system is making only one functional, it's controlling automatically just the lateral control for the steering. So as you see here, the driver initiates the system that he needs to park, and based on the blinker, for example, when he makes the right blinker, the system indicates which side he wants to park. He wants to park in the right side. And the system, the sensing or the ultrasonic system, and here this solution, I can tell you that this solution is based only on ultrasonic, which is one of its greatest challenges. It has its great market share. It's one of our huge cash cows for Valeo for many years, that we are delivering these cheap solutions based only on ultrasonic sensors. And you see here how it's challenging for the sensor system, for the sensing system, that it should measure, for example, the slot very accurately. Imagine if the slot is measured just bigger or narrower than reality, and the system decides to park and it's impossible to park, for example. So it's very challenging here. Either this, as we showed in the previous part for the perpendicular backward parking, and here we show here for the parallel parking, where the vehicle is parking parallel to the curb or to the street pavement. And I think also I remember this video, by the way, it's recorded, I think, at our site in Germany, in Bietigheim. And as you see here, the system is making the motion planning and the control for the vehicle to adjust for the steering and giving the hint for the driver to move forward or backward, and when it's also he should brake in order to stop the vehicle. So the vehicle is making the lateral motion and the hinting for the driver to move forward and backward, as you see for the perpendicular, for the parallel parking, and also for the park out here when he decides the vehicle system should deliver the vehicle outside the slot. These solutions, we can, for example, say that this is the first level of automation, and this is accompanied by another solutions which we can deliver a full autonomous solutions where the vehicle can also the driver can be inside the vehicle, but the vehicle can be making even the longitudinal control. And here in this video, as you will see, we can, I think this video about also 6 or 7 years ago, that was a demo for our vehicle, that the vehicle is moving here in a fully autonomous, that the vehicle is making it both the lateral control and the longitudinal control, and without even interaction from the driver. Sure, he can, he still has the control from the remote if he wants to stop the vehicle. That's why we can call it some sort of level 3. This is some sort like conditional automation where a specific safety critical function for the autonomous parking is achieved for a specific condition here, as you see. And actually, most of our solutions now are based these solutions. That's which we can consider for level 3, and actually, this video which I will show here now is one, let's say, of the most recent, which we can call the connected park for you, or what we can say the valley parking. Actually, this is a demo, and actually it's realized for different demos, but now it's not until now a final product that's running at the customers, which is the vehicle, as you see now. That's the user or the driver sends the command to the vehicle to park, and he is not aware, and he doesn't care even where the vehicle will park, and the vehicle will be connected with the infrastructure, which can be a garage, can be a wide an open area or something, and this infrastructure should be in communication with the vehicle to tell it where is the available slots and how it is, where it's located, and the vehicle then try to locate itself in this area and to make also the motion planning to reach these slots. And when it's finished, it informs the driver, and when also he wants to be back, he just call it back to come again to that position where he has left the vehicle. So this is, for example, we can mention as the fourth level or high automation system of the automation level. I mean, for the driving assistance. Then this is I wanted just from this part to show you how just like something like the parking is innovated and how it's revoluted during the, say, I think the parking started in Valeo more than 10 years ago. Until now, it's one of our major products in different customs. Finally, or the next point, I will need to speak about the connected vehicles, which is one also of our very important topics, how the vehicle can be, at the end, be as an intelligent thing from the Internet of Things, as we see in our different technologies, from the 5G or the Internet of Things in general. As you see here, the BI Intelligence mentioned that during this year, that should be 94 million connected cars. About 80% of the cars should be connected, either connected directly to each other, vehicle-to-vehicle communication, or vehicle-to-infrastructure, or vehicle-to-pedestrian, connected as a node that needs infotainment applications running, like senior user communication, or a vehicle connecting to each other as one of the nodes connecting in the umbrella of the 5G communication. Many of the applications have been established for these connections. Like, for example, as you can see, the vehicle can be acting as a node with its actuators and its sensors connecting with other vehicles in another node, or in another street, or in another city even. I remember one of the project proposals which Daimler, for example, was proposing to have a solution that when a Mercedes or S-Class vehicle is moving in a specific street and covers a specific road to determine the parking slots, it can, for example, put it in a cloud so that other vehicles can interact and capture this information to know before proceeding in this street if there is a slots available for this park for this car dimension or not. Also, the vehicle's communication itself, for example, for the diagnostics, for warnings, if there is a vehicle at the front and its camera is showing a specific accident, how to reflect this show or this capture for the other vehicles for alarming or something. As you see here, for example, this picture, it's a very nice idea for the importance of the connected vehicles. We can have something like a call center to remotely control the vehicle. If the vehicle by the end is a group of sensors and actuators, it's by the end a group of components or nodes, or what we can say, Internet of Things, or they are intelligent things connected to other things which I can control from anywhere remotely, which is one of its examples, as I mentioned to you, the remote parking applications. Also, for example, as you see here, for on the left at the top is something like the flashing of a software in a on air, as it's one of our applications, flash on air. As you see, that can be software updates for the vehicle remotely, and even like as your mobile is updating his software, your vehicle will update its software. For example, you can buy a vehicle that cannot, for example, park, and one day with some updates it can park, for example. So this is also one of the very super ideas how the vehicle by the end will act in the Internet of Things world. Also, let me show you this. I think this video also will give you some impression how the Valeo Xperts, which is one of our products, could get the highest beneficial from the connected vehicles. As you can see here, the front vehicle, front camera, show that some people are crossing the road and give bypassing its data to the vehicle in the behind, which can interpret what is the action or what is the image according to its front camera for to compensate for the position of the vehicle in front of it. It's one of its applications to determine what's exactly happening in front of you. As you can see here, for the takeover situation, which is a very nice application for the extra view. So this is a very nice application, how these connected vehicles can play a very important role in different applications and in different scenarios. So I hope I have covered most of the major topics I want to speak about, or at least the challenges I want to speak about in the driving assistance systems. I hope I will try to play this video. I think maybe the internet is, or bandwidth at my side is better now. So at least I will try to play it in a faster way in order to proceed with the coming topics. So as I mentioned before, it was about 1 month journey along, or more than 1 month, it's 40 days, yeah, or more, across the US, where the driving assistance systems is tested mainly for highways and for the traffic jam in urban roads, mainly for the high functionalities. This is the laser sensor, as you see, and this is the lane change control, for example, when the driver making a lane change, and the system can fully control the vehicle to make the lane change safely. So lane change for only one lane, and here for afterwards, when they reach an urban road or traffic jam, how the system should be behaving, how it should be controlling the steering, controlling the longitudinal speed, making the necessary acceleration and distortion actions, and percepting the different environment structures, like, for example, as you were seeing here, how to sense that the guardrails, as you see, are the metallic parts at the boundaries of the road, how the system should detect it, how the system should detect the lanes itself, in this or traffic jam or urban roads, how to detect it through the different objects, the bicycles, the pedestrians, cyclists, and so on. Yeah. Okay, now I will move to the final and actually, in my opinion, the most important part, which is how to have a qualified engineer to join Valeo or to join the automotive market in general. This is actually a very important topic, and I think this is maybe the main message or the main target from my meeting with you, especially that most of you are students or fresh graduates from the AUC. So let me try first to speak about some major roles in the automotive industry. And one of the most important one is the software engineer. Actually, to be clear with you, Valeo Egypt is at the end an R&D center, and our main product is software. We are, at the end, a software company, and let me tell you that I am proud that, let's say, and it's not an assumption, with numbers, the biggest software company in Egypt, one of the biggest software companies in Egypt, is Valeo. So as we are delivering a software, then we are seeking for qualified software engineers. First, most of our products or most of our software for the embedded is based on C coding. Sure, we can write different or more abstract or less or more detailed programming languages like assembly or languages for specific target or even higher languages, but let's say that at the end, we are having mainly the C embedded C coding, which it's very important to have a highly skilled C programmers. Highly skilled C programmers means that they can write an optimized coding. They can write a coding that's optimized in memory, that can respect all the limitations that we have in memory, in runtime, that can make use of the available libraries only in the C coding, and to write a program efficient that can respect or make use of these libraries in an efficient way. For example, if I'm writing a function that making an extended Kalman filter or making a square root, how can I use the square roots available in the embedded C? I'm not writing a high-level language, I'm not writing a MATLAB or Python. How to respect the precision and the accuracies and the truncation errors possible while I'm writing on these low-level targets? How can I present the floating points? And how can I write a code that's testable, that's understandable, well-structured, well-organized, well-commented, and can be scalable? I can easily extend its functionality. I can easily, it's robust, I can easily migrate it from a project to another. I can easily write a functions that can be standardized and can be reused easily. This is actually something that needs from you to practice a lot and to apply the methods, the standardized methods well known for system for the C programming and for the software process or the software engineering. So this is mainly the first part. Another important role is the algorithms engineer. And it's very important to be aware for the structures and the algorithms, and also to have a solid scientific and mathematics, let's say, basically mathematical background. So you can measure the complexity of your coding in runtime, it's measuring its complexity in memory. You can even apply the complex mathematical approaches in your coding, either based on probabilistic mathematics, as we mentioned, which is very important, as you see, for the mapping and localization, how I can represent the different data coming from the sensors in an engineering aspect, how I can put the process noise or the measurement noise, and how I can formulate it in a mathematical way. That's basically based on the probabilistic mathematics and the fusion techniques accompanied with it. So how I can have this mathematical notation when I am implementing the algorithms itself. So it's very important for an algorithm engineer, either in the localization, either in the map team, even either in the motion planning. When I'm planning a path for the vehicle, this path should be steerable, should be drivable. What's the best path to accomplish? It should be aware explicitly with the geometry, with the trigonometry, with the linear algebra. It's very important aspects. Also, when I am writing something for the vehicle control, how I should be aware explicitly when I'm implementing a coding or a program that's applying a specific algorithm, for example, for the model prediction, the control, even something very simple like the PID controller. How to write in an efficient way and to apply these deep mathematical approaches. So basically, you should be having a pretty solid mathematical information and a mathematical background for these different functionalities. Even by the way, when I'm speaking about the vehicle modeling itself, for the odometry or for the localization, it's very important to know what's mean by the kinematic model, by the dynamics model, and so on. So that's briefly, so to say, that it's very important for the algorithm engineer to be aware from the structures, for the algorithms and for probabilistic mathematics. This is specifically for the developer who is developing these algorithms. Coming back again, as I mentioned, that we are in a very complex environment. Software testing is not an option. Software validation is not something fancy. Software validation is highly mandated. It's very important. And I hope in this meeting, some of the supervisors in AUC and or in the academic part who are supervising the graduation projects, when I see a graduation project, I would like to see a software process being applied. There is, should be a great difference between something you are practicing in an assignment in one of your subjects when you are delivering some program that's making a specific functionality, find that you are applying a Kalman filter, you are applying vehicle modeling, you are applying a specific control technique, you are applying some motion planning approach based on clothoids, Bezier curves, whatever. It's fine that you are applying this for your practicing for a specific assignment, but in a graduation project, when I see the word project means a full software process, which includes the development, as I was saying about the algorithm software engineer, and now includes the testing and the validation. And there should be a requirements written at the beginning for this software. And based on these requirements, according to the desired functionality, there is a design software testing or validation strategy, how to validate or test the software developed that it matches or achieve the required functionality. So software testing, it's very important, and it should be, take its this significant importance in the undergraduate studies and also in the postgraduate studies. Software testing is a very, very important aspect. There is a well-known certificate, which is the ISTQB, the ISTQB is an International Software Testing Qualifications Board for testing. And there's a lot of software testing methodologies that's well-known that should be applied based on the need, based on the architecture, based on the complexity of the project, like the waterfall method, like the agile method, like the iterative method. There should be different approaches for the testing, and it should be, I hope that it should take its part in our studies, either for the undergrad or the for postgrad. Afterwards, there's some sort of the software application engine, for example, the applications, as you mentioned, the automotive industry is huge. It's not just the software running on an embedded environment. We have a lot of applications, especially as you mentioned, for the digital mobility and for the applications, for the software applications, the vehicle is software, like something like a mobile interacting with the cloud, interacting with other web services. So we can have a need for a database, for example, like SQL engineering, like something, writing something on JavaScript. So it's still, the application engine should have a role. Just to give you an impression of one of the applications, I think also I saw it in one of the demos for Daimler, when speaking about the digital mobility, for example, the vehicle could be interacting with the mobile or the device of the driver. So for example, when the driver is coming sooner or coming closer to the vehicle, the system of the vehicle automatically detect that this is the driver of the user and can unlock or lock the vehicle automatically. Also, the system can be automatically measuring the charge, the electrical charge of the vehicle. And for example, if the driver wants to drive, make some trip, for example, the system can interact with the infrastructure, determine the map, determine the route, and for example, put the proper checkpoints based on the available charge for the battery. Okay, you can move this distance and then you can recharge this position without moving away from your road or from your main way to your target and so on. This is, for example, one of the applications, how the vehicle and the software inside the vehicle is interacting with the cloud and interacting with the software and the mobile of the driver. This is, for example, just an example for the different applications for the digital mobility. So that's why the software application engineer is one of our main roles. And again, as I'm speaking about the quality engineer, which is now has become a great pain in the different projects for the different software companies, that we should have a process, a software process that's mandated in our graduation project. And I hope greatly from all the supervisors, specifically for the software engineering departments, either in AUC or in our universities, to have a clear software process during the mentoring and during the scheduling the deliveries for the graduation projects or for any software project, in order to make our students from their beginning learn how to practice this software process. It's not something we are learning and not applying it. We should apply it earlier, and as we apply earlier, we can be graduated more matured and more well trained and we're ready for the market. So it's very important to determine the capability, maturity, model integration, the CMMI, how we define the different maturity for the process. One of its, for example, is SPICE, which is Automotive Software Performance Improvement and Capability Determination. It's something, it's a standard put by the OEMs for specific for the automotive. In order to give you a humble example, to show you, are your product or are your software you are delivering has a specific process, or how much is it agile? How much is it mature? For example, if you are making your project on an ARM processor, you are making something like a very simple software that's making some specific functionality, some robot, for example. And if I tell you, okay, this is a graduation project that the students are making a robot that's making specific functionalities based, for example, on an ARM or some specific hardware. If I tell you them, okay, what about if you wanted to migrate your software on another hardware, on Arduino or another hardware platform? How much it will take from you to make the proper changes in your software to run on this hardware? If I got an answer that you are making everything from scratch, again, this means clearly that you are not following any process in your software development, which is a very poor performance, very poor quality. If I can easily migrate from my software as high level, it's well written with high level language, well abstracted, and from it, for example, I'm writing something on MATLAB and making some good auto generation to run a specific target, in just seconds I can make it for another target, and it's really agile software. So I'm just giving you an example how I am following a software process when I'm making my deliveries, and this is very important to understand in your undergrad, if it's possible. If not, then it should be at least in the postgraduate studies. However, I greatly recommend to be done in the undergrad. Finally, here I want to speak about the software testing and the virtual testing and software simulation. I'm just picking for you here one of examples for the Ford automated system simulation. It's made Ford, for example, which is one of the well-known OEMs, making a full simulation for its software in the loop, for the software running on the vehicle. And actually, this is a project, it's a well-known project, something that I am contributing in it, that they are making this based on Simulink and MATLAB. So it's very important that how to simulate in a software your solutions, and a simulation has become a product. It's not an option. It's something also mandated in your software process. So how you can simulate your environment, how you can build your simulation tools, and how you can interconnect between your software components running on target on another software tools high level in order that can be for you to monitor and simulate the different situations in abstract and in regression way before the real integration on target to save money and save time and to make sure to have the earlier detections for errors. As you can see here, this is one of the setups that's what we call a vehicle emulator. That's not just to simulate the software, but to emulate the full cycle, the full product, starting from the software running to the real hardware or to the mimic the hardware functionality, the vehicle dynamics, the vehicle kinematics, the surrounding detections in a real, almost real environment, which we call a vehicle emulator, or what we call virtually a vehicle in the loop, a vehicle inside the test. So finally, what's one of our new roles that we are gaining even in Valeo Egypt, and its importance is increasing step by step. And actually, that's one of my even roles in Valeo, which is a system engineering. System engineering is very important in nowadays, specifically for the different products that are interacting with customers and has an end user specific functionality. System engineer that will establish or collect the user requirements and will formulate it in a standardized and understandable way to be formulated from it, the solutions customized, how to achieve these requirements and to be interpreted to, if you are speaking about software, how to interpret it for the software requirements to be guarded while we are writing our software. This is mainly the system engineering, and sure, it should be based on very deep mathematical and the physical algorithms and physical background, and it's very important this scientific information to be granted to be earned deeply during your study. Also, the artificial intelligence and the machine learning and deep learning techniques, which is very important to design when you are putting the design for your solutions, and through also the modeling, simulation, and system architecture. So, this is also some samples of the tools used for the system modeling. So, just to highlight, this is one of the roles, and let me show you in a fast this video, which just to reveal to you the testing, how the vehicles are tested. This Euro NCAP, or the Euro New Car Assessment Program, which nowadays has become a certificate for any vehicle to be sold in Europe, you should satisfy this Euro NCAP. So now, as you can see, it's a video for any vehicle now that should be assisted or should be achieving the driving assistance systems to have this group of well-standardized sensors for the different detections at highways, for the roads, for the guardrails, for the lanes, for the different functionalities, even for emergency braking, for lane changing, as we mentioned here. And this is some samples for the tester tracks, for the testing for these different functionalities and some KPIs in order how to test this in a numbered way, to have some numbers for the difference, as you see, well-known products of different cars recent. This is some of the tests when a vehicle come suddenly to your lane, when a vehicle just suddenly move, and even how the vehicle is intuitive with the driver actions, how it's smooth to act with the driver sudden inputs. This is also one of the testings that's happening for the car. Just I give you that's the vehicle production and the vehicle testing, and also the system engineering has a big role in these situations. It's one of the important aspects, and it's an industry in itself. The OEMs are investing in this system, in this test tracks, numbers that doesn't. I mean, it's not. It's very, very near to the number they are investing in their in the production. So that's just to give you this testing. How it's very important in the automotive market. So just before I finish, I hope I have reached at least the messages I want to tell you. So just to summarize, I have three important messages to you, specifically for the engineers and the postgrads, and sure the students undergrad. The scientific background you are learning in your college, in your university, is very important, and how its depth is very important. Number two, the programming skills and how much you are practicing is very important also. And there is a lot of several trainings and courses. We are in Valeo delivering trainings, and also there are a lot of courses and trainings also like Coursera, like edX, like Udacity, the learning degree in Udacity, and so on. There is a lot of courses and trainings that should be important for the practicing. Programming skills will not be achieved or not be enhanced without clear and deep practicing. And third, the testing techniques and how much you are practicing it, and the software process. It's actually a very, very important for you, and sure this will be very important for us when you join. Thank you, and I hope I have give you an interesting session, and I am sure I am welcome for your questions. يعني جميع الطلبة لو حابين يسألوا طبعا باللغة العربية أو حابين يتكلموا في أي حاجة طبعا تحت أمرهم. ولو في أي حاجة طبعا مش واضحة في البرزنتيشن شوف طبعا I am welcome to revisit again.
Thank you so much, Dr. Mohamed. Thank you all. إن شاء الله بعد السيشن ما تخلص we will be sending you a feedback work. Please fill in it. Thank you all for attending. We would love to hear thoughts about the session and how did it go. And thank you all for coming here. Thank you, Dr. Mohamed. Thank you.
You are welcome, Samah. And if you have any questions, I'll be able to answer them. Then, as we saw in the
video,
Dr. Radwan, there is a question on the chat. You can see it.
Overtaking scenarios, as we saw, when I communicate.
تمام طيب انا في سؤال عبد الرحمن an extra piece of advice for someone who wants to start a career in R&D or academia who has been out of the academic lane for a while and with no experience in the field of or relevant graduation project. يعني هو عايز يبدا عايز extra advice علشان هيبدا start a career في R&D او في الاكاديميا مكان بعيد عن الاكاديميك مثلا. انا يعني هكلمك بمنتهى الصراحه عبد الرحمن, انا شخصيا يعني كنت دخلت الجيش فتره برضه 3 سنين ورجعت تاني للاكاديميك ريسيرش, مفيش مشكله. اهم حاجه يعني لو انت سؤالك على R&D بشكل عام, تكون عندك الانفو او عندك الباك جراوند السوليد ده اول حاجه, الماثيماتيكال باك جراوند الستيت اوف ارت, عارف قاري كتير في مشاكل السنسور, في مشاكل الديتكشنز, في مشاكل البلاننج, في مشاكل الكنترول, في مشاكل الانتجريشن, في مشاكل الفاليديشن, في مشاكل التستنج. عندك قرايه, عندك نو هاو, عندك ستيت اوف ارت in depth عندك physical أو mathematical أو scientific background. ده أهم بداية تبدأ منها. ده كان الأرضية اللي بنتكلم عنها. أنا نجي بحضر ماجستير أو بحضر دكتوراه 60% من المجهود 60% من مجهود الماجستير أو الدكتوراه أو أي بحث علمي عايز أعمله إن أنا بحضر الستيت أوف أرت. هي الناس عملت إيه وإيه الحاجات اللي عملها فلان واللي عملهاش فلان وده عمل إيه وده ما عملش إيه وإيه مزايا ده وإيه عيوب ده. الأول أجمع الناس اشتغلت في إيه المشاكل اللي موجودة. ده في حد ذاته ممكن يشكل 60-70%. والجزء اللي فاضل هو إن أنا إزاي ممكن يبقى عندي تاتش أو إزاي أنا أحقق إيه الإنبوتس اللي ممكن أحطها. طيب لو بنتكلم في فيلد الأوتوموتيف زي ما أنت شايف الفيلد كبير واسع جدا. في أكتر من حاجة ممكن تخدم فيها وممكن تدخل فيها. لو بتكلم مثلا في الأوتونوموس درايفنج إحنا عندنا أنا لمست ثلاث حاجات أساسية: البرسبشن أو الديتكشن أو الإنفايرمنت موديلينج أو الإنفايرمنت ديتكشن. وده في مشاكل كتير جدا. انا عندي رايات بتيجي من سنسورز. ده انا كل سنسور في حد ذاتهم هو توبيك اوف هاي توبيك اوف ريسيرش. الالتراسونيك لوحده توبيك اوف ريسيرش. انا نفسي اشوف جامعه في مصر عندها لاب قوي في الالتراسونيك. ده سنسور يعني سنسور مشهور ومنتشر ورخيص. ليه ما عندناش لاب قوي في الالتراسونيك؟ في الوايرلس سنسور نتورك، في الرادار سنسورز، الليزر او اللايدر سنسور. بقول لك دلوقتي ان الكومبريس بيتم في كومبيتيشن عميقه وقويه جدا. ازاي انا اعمل الترا ليزر سنسور بحجم صغير بما يبقى بحيث ان يبقى كان بي سولد ستيت وين تشيب برايس لو انا اقدر احطه في العربيه ان ستيبل كان بي ماونتد ستيبل وذ ستيبل ما يبقاش مهزوز ما يبقاش ما يتحط في مكان في العربيه زي الكاميرا كده حط في الروف كاميرا صغيره. طب السنسور ده سنسور كبير حطه تحت في العربيه حطه في الاصطدام. طب ده هيبقى حاجه عرض الاهتزاز ده هيبقى مشكله. ازاي اعمل حاجه اكيوريت من سمول بيس. انا عايز اوصلك مثلا ده بس انا بكلم بس جزئيه بكلم بس جزئيه بس الديتكشن بكلم بس جزئيه السنسور البوست بروسيسنج اللي ممكن يتعمل في السنسور وايه مشاكل السنسور ديتكشن. ناس بتاعه الكوميونيكيشن اكيد قاريه كتير وعارفه مثلا حاجات مشاكل كتير مثلا في الرادار او الدوبلر افكت او مشاكل الريفليكشنز او الراديشنز او النويز اللي ممكن تحصل. ده في حاجاته فيري توبيك فيري هيوج توبيك اوف ريسيرش ان انا يبقى عندي نو هاو في السنسور موديلنج مشاكل السنسور الفيزيكال لير بتاعته مشاكلها ايه. طب لما احب اموديل ده ايه البوست بروسيسنج اللي ممكن يتعمل ليه وايه الفلترز اللي ممكن تتركب فيه وايه احسن فلترز ممكن تتركب في الجزئيه دي وبناء على ده. طيب لما اجي خلاص انا جبت اخر من السنسور ازاي لما اطلع السنسور ده للير اللي بعد مني اقول له بص بقى خد السنسور ده بالنويز موديل الفلاني. ازاي احط سيستماتيك او احط اكوريت نويز موديل للسنسور بتاعي. يعني انت لو بتقول لي حاجه انا في الابر لاير بتقول لي حاجه دي مش كويسه بس انت بتقول انها مش كويسه وبتقول مش كويسه بنسبه كذا ده حاجه كويسه جدا بالنسبه لي حاجه كويسه جدا. انا عرفت مشاكلك فاعرف مشاكلك دي ازاي اخدها في اعتباري وبعمل فيوجن بينك وبين واحد ثاني. فدي حاجه ممتازه مش وحشه. يعني احنا عندنا مثلا ممكن عندي ليميتيشن في السنسور بتاعي في التصنيع بتاعه بس انا عرفت اتغلب على المشاكل دي بان انا عرفت اعمل لها موديل مظبوط وانا بكفر ده او انا بتراك ده عامل بقى بعد كده هعمل فيوجن بيزد على رو داتا بيزد على فيتشر بيزد فيوجن اوبجكت بيزد فيوجن حسب الليفل فيوجن اللي بعمله. فده انا بديك مثال هنا ان انت لازم الستيت اوف ارت لازم عندي الفيزيكال والماثماتيكال باك جراوند الامبورتنت قويه جدا في الويفز وفي الانتنا وفي حسابات الديتكشنز وفي الريفليكشنز. لازم عندي الفيزيكال باك جراوند دي كويسه جدا وثابته جدا وقويه جدا وبعد كده ببدا ابني عليها بقى بشويه ريسيرش اقعد اقرا شويه. طيب الجامعه الفلانيه اشتغلوا في ايه؟ طب الناس دي اشتغلت في ايه؟ طب الناس دي وصلت لايه؟ في حاجات كتير اوبن موجوده يعني سواء بنتكلم على بيبرز او ابلكيشنز حاجات كتير موجوده وفي ديموز كتير موجوده. الحاجات دي ابدا منها اقوي الستيت اوف ارت بتاعي يبقى عندي باك جراوند محترمه ابدا منها ابدا بسهوله ابدا ريسيرش. انا عايز اقول لك من اكبر الببلكيشنز القويه المعتبره في مجلات كتير بتبقى في الاخر عباره عن ستيت اوف ارت عباره عن سيرفي وده في حد ذاته حاجه قيمه جدا في الريسيرش. اتمنى اكون جاوبت على سؤالك. انا بس في اسئله حاجات كتبت لك انا اسف ممكن اكون طولت في السؤال. What the future of LiDAR given that it has strong فعلا future of LiDAR فعلا زي ما بقول لك كله بيتسابق دلوقتي على solid state LiDAR. ازاي نستعمل سوليد ستيت لايدر لايدر في حجم صغير باكيورسي عاليه بكوست قليل. امبيدد لينكس حاجه في منتهى الاهميه. الامبيدد لينكس حاجه اوبن كله بينفست فيها. يمكن انا نسيت اتكلم شويه عن اهميه الجزئيه الاوبريتنج سيستمز دلوقتي وازاي ان احنا بقى هيبقى عندنا زي الاركتكتشر جديد ما عادش فيه بقى سنسورز كتير. انا بقى ممكن يبقى عندي سنسورز مختلفه من كاستمرز مختلفه في الاخر نجمع كل السوفت وير بتاعي في وان بيج مين شيب وده هيخلي التحديات بقى بين الديفرنت هيبقى عندي هيوج تاسكس رانينج هيوج تاسكس اكسسنج ريسورسز اكسسنج الميموري يبقى انا عندي very complex very solid and agile operating system even though لسه مش حاطين له full standard عشان كده من Linux is a challenging and is a great advantage operating system in this stage ان هو لسه بيتكون لسه مش محطوط standard للموضوع الاركتكتشر بيزيد تعقيده فانا عايز حاجه طبعا سهل ان انا بلعب في التايمنج سينكرونايزيشن بتاعها في الميموري مانجمنت بتاعتها في الانتر اكشنز مع الدياجنوستكس في الانتر اكشنز مع البيزك سوفت وير لايرز فهنا الامبيد لينكس مهم جدا طبعا الناس تتعلم وانا ما بنكرش طبعا اوتوسار الناس طبعا عارفاها طبعا وبالذات طبعا ادابتيف هو ادابتيف اوتوسار اتس ان ادفانسد توبيك عن الاوتوسار و اي ثينك you can start يعني at least على الأقل في عندنا يعني في official courses احنا بنحاول برضو يعني عندنا experts الحمد لله في very bold اوتوسار I hope they are making courses open or outside value وده ممكن طبعا يعني برضو يبقى من خلال ال ETM أو من خلال knowledge department بتاع value ممكن يعني يبقى في تعاون وإن يحاول يبقى في كورسز للأدابتف أوتوسار هوب أوتوسار على الأقل مع الجامعات ده بحاجة كويسة جدا إنها تقوي our background وفي I think topics في materials resources كتير جدا ممكن طبعا إن إحنا نقراها نبص فيها أنا بس أسئلة بتيجي كتير فأنا عشان كده هحاول أسرع شوية The importance of mathematical background, the investments for a postgrad, how you would suggest improving such skills. بمنتهى الوضوح. أول حاجة الحاجة اللي تعلمتها في كورس كوفيما. يعني معلش أنا آسف يعني هبدأ كده من الصفر. الماثماتكس والفيزيكس اللي خدتها في إعدادي وحتى في الثانوية العامة. أنا عايز أقول لك اللينير الجبر اللي خدناها دي. أنا يعني لازم تكون فاهمها كويس جدا. لازم تكون فاهم اللينير الجبر والكالكولس والتريجنومتري والجيومتري. الحاجات الاساسيات اللي خدتها في رياضه في ثانويه عامه ورياضه اعدادي هندسه واولى كهرباء ولا اولى ميكانيكا او وات ايفر الحاجات دي مهمه جدا تبقى فاهمها كويس جدا لان دي اللي بتبني عليها لو مش فاهمها ما تقوليش هاخد كورس بكورس لازم تكون فاهم الكلام ده لازم تكون فاهم كويس جدا والحمد لله ان انت تلاقي عندك ليه ماتيريالز وتلاقي عندك فيه كتب خدتها فيه البراكتسنج بتاعك مهم جدا فيه ده اول حاجه لازم تكون فاهمها كويس تكون ماسكها كويس بعد كده هتخش في مرحله ال التطبيق شوية يعني عندك بقى في كورسز في كورسيرا او في ايديكس او في او واتيفر او حتى لو عايز تاخد كورسز في الاي تي اي او واتيفر الكورسز دي حتى بقى تابلاي فيها التكنيكس او الماثيماتيكال ابروتشز دي لازم تكون فاهمها كويس جدا مش ينفع اشتغل في كنترول وانا اصلا مش فاهم يعني انتجريشن مش ينفع اتكلم في لابلاس ترانسفورم وانا عمري ما شفت السميشن مش فاهم بزيد ترانسفورم وهكذا لازم اكون فاهم الديب ماثيماتكس الاول بعد كده ببدأ أخش في التطبيقات والتطبيقات الكورسز ليها كتير جدا لو نتكلم على مرحلة التطبيقات وأكيد أنت برضو أكيد لازم تطبق ده في المواد اللي تاخدها بعد كده سنة في تالتة أو رابعة أو لو أنت عندك مادة في البوست جراد أو طبعا في الجراديوشن بروجكت أو كورسز اللي أنت بتطبق فيها هل يمكن زيادة الفرص المتاحة للإمبيدد إنجينيرز؟ أوريدي في فرص متاحة وإن شاء الله الحمد لله بعد يعني الحمد لله موضوع يعني الكوفيد الحمد لله الدنيا بدأت تتفتح أكتر وأكتر وإن شاء الله يعني الحمد لله افتكرت المصطلح أنا آسف كنت كونسبت الدومين كنترولر لأن يعني عندنا كومبو بروجكتس وسوفت وير كبير بيجمع ديفرنت إيسيوز وديفرنت فانكشناليتيز وده برضه هيسمع اكيد في الكومبلكس بتاع الاوبريتنج سيستم ده. وده ترند دلوقتي في الاوتوموتيف ماركت. اي ثينك البروجكتس الكومبو بروجكتس دي هتفتح لنا الحمد لله ان شاء الله فرص كويسه كمان بالذات باذن الفتره الجايه بالذات للامبيدد انجينيرز ان شاء الله. ميكاترونكس انجينير جرادويت. اي توك ذا موديلنج بارت ان ماي جرادويشن بروجكت. كويس جدا. اي توك ذا موديل بيز ديزاين سويفت اكت كومباني سيمولينك. ممتاز. اي وانت تو ديفلوب ماي سيلف فيلد اند انتر هذا السيستم اللي انت عملته على ماتلاب وعملته سيمولينك طبق عليه الادا سيستمز. ما تعمل موديل العربيه وحركها في هاي واي حركها في رود واستخدم السنسور مودلز الموجوده جوه الماتلاب استعمل الايمج سنسور استعمل السنسور استعمل الالتراسونيك انتجريت كار ميكر مع 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 ماتلاب او السيمولينك وحرك العربيه في انفايرمنت مور كومبلكس. انا عايز اقول لك ده الاكزامبل اللي كنت بوريك النهارده في فورد الفاست او الفورد انفايرمنت تيستينج الفاست استاذ وريتك فيها عن فورد سيميليشن انفايرمنت هي حاجه شبيهه بده. هم عاملين حاجات بيزد على كار مودلز بيزد على كار ميكر او كار سيم وانتجريتوها على مودلز عاملينها على سيميلينك. ازاي ممكن اطلع داتا من كار ميكر لان ده ان ريتش انفايرمنت للتستنج للفيكل موديلنج للسوفت وير سينسينج للانفايرمنت بيرسبشن وانتجريت ده على سيميلينك احط فيه ماي الجوريثمز سواء للفيكل كنترول سواء الجوريثمز للبوست بروسيسنج سواء الجوريثمز للمابينج واللوكاليزيشن. ازاي ممكن اعمل حركه العربيه مثلا في تانل ولوكاليزها بالالجوريثم بتاعي على سيميلينك واحركها هنا وبحركها جوه كار ميكر مثلا. حاول يعني ابدا بده. بقيت عندك نولج كويسه في الكار موديل وعندك نولج كويسه بسيميلينك عايز تطبق ده على الادس طبق ابلكيشن يبقى فيها الكار موديل دوت بينتر اكت مع سيميلينك. عامل انت مثلا سي زي ما بقول لك مثلا كنترولر عامل باث موديل عامل باث العربيه تمشي عليه عشان تعمل لين تشينج وعامل لها كنترول عشان تتحرك عليه بسبيدز مختلفه. طب احرك اعملها بسبيدز ويورتس مختلفه وشوف العربيه ايه اللي هيحصل فيها وشوف الكنترول بتاعها هيبيهيف ازاي. العربيه هتقلب ولا مش هتقلب لو مثلا عايز اتحرك على سرعه عاليه على دوران ملف. طبعا الجزئيه برضه الفيكل كاينماتكس والفيكل دراسه مهمه جدا. يعني ايه اندر ستيرنج؟ يعني ايه اوفر ستيرنج؟ يعني ايه سيلف ستيرنج؟ يعني ايه سليبنج؟ يعني ايه سبيننج؟ يعني ايه العجل بيسبين؟ يعني ايه العجل بيسليب؟ يعني العجل العربية بتدريفت؟ يعني ايه تأثير الفريكشن فورسز؟ ايه المودل اللي معمول اللي ممكن تعمله العربية؟ هل تعمل فور ويل مودل؟ هل تعمل بايسكل مودل؟ هل تعمل كينيماتيك ولا دايناميك مودل؟ هل تاخد تأثير الفريكشن فورسز؟ تاخد تأثير اللاترال فورس؟ تاخد تأثير الويند فورسز؟ تاخد تأثير الايرو داينامكس؟ فده مهم جدا وده ليه دراسة وعايزك تدرسه وعايزك تتعلمه وانت بتطبق الكلام اللي انت بتطبقه ده. سنسورز فيوجن يوزنج سي او سي بلس الاثنين اللي انت عايزه اكتب سي الاحسن طبعا. انا كان اكتب سي لان انا في الاخر هبقى مور للماركت بس مفيش مشكله ما نحتاجش نكتب سي بلس بلس ونكتب على عندنا كومبايلرز سي بلس بلس وننزل بالامبيدد على سي على سي بلس بلس مفيش مشكله. الفرق بينهم مش 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 خطير. لو عايز تعمل مكتوب اتفضل. طبعا
سمعت يا دكتور حضرتك وضحت في الرود ماب الارتفيشال انتليجنس ماشين ليرنينج والبايثون
تمام
بس حضرتك ما قلتش تفاصيل عنها يعني هل انا محتاج ادرس المجال كله لان حضرتك عارف الفيلد كبير قوي
تمام
حضرتك اكيد قصدك في الجزء ده بالنسبه للاوتونوماس في الجزء بتاع الكمبيوتر فيجن
تمام
مش الحاجات دي
مش شرط كمبيوتر فيجن اتفضل يا سعيد اتفضل الاول اتفضل
هل انا ادرس امبيدد سي وار 2 اس والالجوريزم والحاجات دي كلها بلس الماشين ليرنينج عشان اشتغل في البروبلم دي؟
جميل جدا. بص الماشين ليرنينج يعني خلينا نقول ايه في 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 حاجات اساسيه ليه. انا مثلا لما اجيب واحد نجار عندي البيت النجار ده معاه شاكوش ده معاه عدته العده بتاعتك كمهندس العده بتاعتك اللي انت لازم تكون يعني ديك ورجليك البروجرامينج سكيلز programming languages الكابابيلتس بتاعتك في الـ دي اي او في الـ في الديفلوبمنت انفايرمنت اللي انت بتشتغل عليها شغال بتعرف تكتب كود سي كويس جدا بتعرف تكتب كود امبيدد كويس جدا بتعرف تكتب كود ماتلاب بتعرف تكتب كود بايثون عارف اللايبريز بتاع ده وبتاع ده دي ايديك ورجليك. طب ايه بقى المهارات اللي انا محتاجها عشان اعرف استعمل الادوات دي كويس؟ محتاج اتعلم ماشين ليرنينج اتعلم نيورال نتورك او ديب ليرنينج عشان اعرف ابلاي ده على مور كومبلكس بروبلمز. المشين ليرنينج ده هو في الاول والاخر بنتكلم على كلمه فلتر, بنتكلم على فيوجن سنسور فيوجن, هو ده سام سورت اوف ايه اوف ماشين ليرنينج. انا عشان اعرف اطبق المشين ليرنينج ده محتاج ان انا يبقى عندي, ارجع خطوه الاول كده, ما انا مش هاخد كورس كلمه فلتر او اخد كورس سنسور فيوجن وانا اصلا ما اعرفش ماثماتكس وانا اصلا ما اعرفش فيزيكس. مش هاخد حاجه اتعلمها في حتى لو دي هشرح حتى ديب ليرنينج او هعمل نيورونز وانا اصلا ما عنديش, ما اعرفش يعني ايه ترانسفير فانكشن, ما اعرفش يعني ايه البريزنت تانش او ساين او 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 سموث ترانزيشن فانكشنز. انا اصلا ما خدتهاش, لا لازم اكون عارف الساين وعارف الانفرس ساين اللي فانكشنز ممكن استعملها في ترانسفورميشنز جوه الفايرنج انجن بتاع النيورال نتورك او جوه وات ايفر حاجه هستعملها مثلا في الماشين ليرنينج, هعمل حاجه سام بروبابيليتي. لازم اعرف يعني ايه ديستريبيوشن, يعني ايه يعني ايه نورمال ديستريبيوشن, يعني ايه بوسون ديستريبيوشن, يعني ايه كيمي ديستريبيوشن, يعني ايه مين, يعني ايه كوفاريانس, يعني ايه لايكليهود. لازم ابقى فاهم الماثيماتيكال كونسبت دي عشان اعرف افهم كويس, ابقى كويس في الماشين ليرنينج. فهي في الاخر الطرق الحاجات اللي بتعلمها علشان اقدر ابلاي الحاجات الشاكوش بايديا. يعني انا خلاص بقى عندي حاجات في ايديا وعندي المهارات اللي انا هستعملها وانا بابلاي الكلام ده. فمهم لازم الاثنين يمشوا مع بعض, يعني ما عندي البروجرامينج سكيلز ويبقى عندي النو هاو بتاع الماثماتكس بتاع الماشين ليرنينج اللي هابلاي الحاجات بالتولز او بالسي كودينج او بالحاجات البروجرامينج سكيلز اللي عارفها. اتمنى اكون جاوبت على سؤالك, لو عندك برضو اي نقطه ثانيه تحت امرك. مش انت الكورسز حد بس بعت لي, هبص بسرعه على الكورس اللي هو بعتها نيكست تكنولوجي ليدرز اجايل ديفلوبمنت. طبعا دي حاجه مهمه جدا, وده بتكلم عن الاجايل سوفت وير اي اي. بص انا يعني مش عايز بس اغوط, لكن واضح ان في حاجات الديف اوبس على فكره ده هيبقى برضه ستاندرد ابروتش في الديفلوبمنت, هو مش موجود عندنا قوي لكن هيبقى موجود يعني منتشر في شركات كتير في فودافون وذلك, وممكن طبعا هيبقى له اكيد اي شركه سوفت وير هيبقى لها ستاندردايزد واي في الديف اوبس دوت. انا يعني ما طرقتوش كتير بس اتوقع يبقى ستاندرد ابروتش البايثون والتنسور فلو او عامه كونسبت ديب ليرنينج ده مهم جدا. انتدرشن سيلف درايفنج نانو ديجري حاجه ممتازه ما تخش فيها, يوداستي اهو كورس اليوداستي الانترودكشن للسيلف درايفنج هديك على الاقل بيزكس قعدت اتكلمت فيها النهارده شويه, هكلمك شويه على البرسبشن, هكلمك شويه عن هديك بروبلمز صغيره في الفيوجن, هديك بروبلمز صغيره في الموشن بلاننج, هديك بروبلمز صغيره في الفيجن كنترول, هيخليك تتش حته حته كده من البروبلمز اللي انا النهارده اتكلمت عنها شويه. كورس من ضمن الكورسات اللي موجوده في اللينك اللي انت بعته يا شهاب. محمد ناصر is embedded system using in power electronics circuit is very has a hardware part in Egypt. حاجة جزء power electronics موجود ومطلوب بس مش مطلوب عندي أنا الحقيقة يا محمد, مطلوب في PTS في power training system. أنا أول السلايد كلمت شوية عن حاجة اسمها في Valeo اسمها business groups. عندنا business group الكبير أول هو comfort and driving assistance اللي أنا جزء منه أو شغال فيه, اللي هو جزء الـ driving assistance systems والـ terminal control أو interior controls. ده حاجة ما فيهاش شغل power electronic circuits صراحة. شغل power electronic circuits أكتر موجود ناحية ده electrification ناحية power training systems وده برضو موجود الحمد لله, وفي عندنا جزء في Valeo والحمد لله I think في نيد لباور الكترونكس انجينيرز الموجودين فيه, وان شاء الله يبقى لك دور فيهم باذن الله يا محمد. وموجود الحمد لله في الديبارت بتاع بي تي اس اللي هو باور تريننج سيستمز. Should I spend my time in improving my skills in mathematics simulation and control theory and apply projects analysis and or should start with taking courses and acquire embedded. ما هو الفكره, ما هو انا قصدي الاثنين مع بعض. ما قصدي انا باخد كورس والكورس ده انا هاخد فيه assignment او project هابلاي فيه الكلام ده زي الفل. يعني هي فكره, هما حاجتين ما بين شقوش عن بعض, scientific background والتكنيكال براكتس الاثنين مع بعض. الكورس ده هيديني scientific background معلومات هقراها, اعرف الكلمن فلتر يعني ايه كلمن فلتر اصلا, يعني ايه فيوجن, يعني يعني ايه probability distribution, يعني ايه مين, يعني ايه كوفاريانس, يعني ايه بعمل ماثيماتيكال ابروتش انا اعمل بريدكشن واعمل اوبزرفيشن او اعمل كوركشن. فاين ده ماثيماتكس, ده ساينس, بتعلمه. طيب ازاي ابلاي الكلام ده اكتب بيه كود؟ ازاي اكتب الكود ده على كامبيدد؟ وازاي ارنه على تارجت؟ ده حاجه جميله، ده براكتس. الكورس هيديني الاثنين، ممتاز. الكورس هيديني حاجه واحده، يبقى اخد حاجه تانية من حته تانية، او اخد يعني اقرف ده شويه واخد كورس في براكتس. المهم ان ابلاي الاثنين. تمام.
هو السلام عليكم.
اتفضل. عليكم السلام. اتفضل.
انا بس انا كنت عشان بس لو حضرتك فهمتني غلط في السؤال ده، انا نفس الشخص اللي كنت بسال من شويه على السيميولينك واللي انا مشيت فيه وخدت انترنشيب وكده.
تمام.
سؤالي انا دلوقتي ماشي في اتجاه الموديل بيست ديزاين، هل اكمل بقى عليه؟ طبعا ماتماتكس والكنترول ثيوري دي انا كنت متوقع وفهمت من حضرتك برضو ان هي حاجه لازم افضل اذاكرها طول العمر يعني واطور نفسي.
زيك انا على فكره، زيك، انا بقالي كذا سنه متخرج وبطور نفسي وبتعلم فيها زيك على فكره.
عشان هي بحر كبير.
هي حاجه تمام.
فانا بتكلم بقى ان انا هو الطريق ده غير ان انا اخد كورس سي او اعرف الاركتكتشر او بروجرامينج سي، يعني ده هل ده طريق وده طريق تاني ولا هما الاثنين مع بعض؟ يعني انا دلوقتي مشيت في حته في الموديل بيز والسيمي لينك، لازم اخد السي بروجرامينج معايا برضو ولا
هو بص يا احمد، هنا مطلوب روح. لو انت يا احمد يعني لسه متخرج او لسه بتدور على فرص شغل، فمعلوماتك في السي بروجرامينج بتسمى تقول كده بتعلي الفرص بتاعتك. لو جات لي فرصه في الامبيدد، وعلى فكره احنا الحمد لله بيطلب عندنا اوبورتيونيتيز في الموديل بيز ديزاين، وعندنا في بروجكتس بنشتغل فيها في الرول ده. فاذا جالك حاجه فيه انت الحمد لله جاهز. طب ما جاليش حاجه فيه وجالي بس في اوبورتيونيتي سوفت وير انجينير، امبيدد سوفت وير انجينير، فعايز اعلي برضو الاوبورتيونيتيز بتاعتي في الفيكنسيز ديت، يبقى خلاص يبقى اخد ده شويه وباخد يعني حسب انت في اي مرحله. لا انا اشتغلت خلاص وبقيت شغال دلوقتي في الام بي دي وعايز اطور نفسي، اوكي فاين، يبقى اطور نفسك في الام بي دي موديل بيز ديزاين. هتشتغل على سيميلينك، تشتغل على ستيت ميت، تشتغل على ماتلاب، بتشتغل على ديفرنت بروجكتس انتجريت مع ديفرنت تولز او ديفرنت سيميليشن مودلز زي ما كنت بقول لك كارميكر او كارسيم. بحط تيستينج سيناريوز مختلفه، بعرف ازاي انتجريت ريكويرمنتس جوه الستيت ميت او جوه السيميلينك، بعرف اعمل ازاي اوتوميتد كود جينيريشن منهم. هو ده كلها سكيلز بتعلمها وانا جوه الام بي دي. ابلاي الكلام ده كله وتعلمه لو انت اوريدي خلاص دخلت فيه وشايف ان انت عندك اوبورتيونيتيز فيه. لا انا لسه بدور مش شايف، خلاص باخد من ده شويه وبعلي برضه السكيلز بتاعتي في السي بروجرامنج. مش هخسر، وخصوصا ان انا مثلا جيت اشتغلت في بروجكت وانا اشتغلت انا دخلت كام بي دي وهعمل كود اوتو جينيريشن. طب جه قال لك للاسف الحق البروجكت ده مش هنشتغل كود اوتو جينيريشن، ده احنا هنكتب كود سي. البروجكت اتغير، يبقى انا الرول بتاعتي كنت هعمل احط الديزاين وهيتعمل له اوتو جينيريشن، لا انا هحط الديزاين وهامبلمنته سي، يبقى لازم اتعلم ده واتعلم ده. فهي حاجه هتفيدني على حسب برضو انت في اي مرحله، بس اوفر اول ده هيفيدك وده هيفيدك.
تمام. يعني الطريقين ناسب بدون مقاطعه، يعني الطريقين ما هيفيدوني في تراك الاداس يعني بعد كده بقى، يعني هيبقى معايا الاثنين دول كبيزكس عشان ابتدي اخش بقى على الاداس وورلد يعني.
بالظبط. انا مع يعني ده الاثنين اكيد هيفيدوك. هي في الاخر والاول والاخر يا جماعه عشان اكون دقيق جدا وواضح جدا، تاني هي حاجتين لازم دايما يشتغلوا مع بعض، التكنيكال براكتس واللي قبله الساينتفك باك جراوند، الساينتفك نولج، الساينتفك انفورميشن. انا انت مثلا بتعمل حاجه على سيميلينك بتعمل كار موديل، طب الكار موديل اللي جوه كار ميكر شغال ازاي؟ لو شغال فور ويل موديل ولا شغال بايسكل موديل، ولا انا ممكن اشيله خالص واعمل موديل انا مزاجي اقول انا صح اقول احسن منه. طب الموديل ده يعني ايه؟ يعني ايه فور ويل موديل؟ الموديل ده بياخد في اعتباره ايه؟ بياخد في اعتباره الداينامكس، بياخد في اعتباره الكيناماتكس، دي كلها ساينس لازم اكون متعلمها، بيزد على ميكانكس، بيزد على ماثماتكس، لازم اكون بيزد على فيزيكس، لازم ابقى فاهمها. فده ساينس، ساينتفك باك جراوند. طيب ازاي استعمل الماتلاب؟ ازاي اعمل كود اوتو جينيريشن؟ ازاي انتجريت كود سي جوه الماتلاب؟ ازاي انتجريت حاجه جوه السيميلينك؟ ازاي اطلع انتركت انترفيس ماتلاب مع بايثون؟ دي كلها تكنيكال براكتس، فلازم الاثنين دايما يفضلوا ماشيين مع بعض.
باشمهندس I'm sorry to interrupt بس احنا we are running out of time ف
unfortunately.
تمام. It's totally fine. انا بس suggesting انه باقي الشباب لو لسه عندنا اي questions او اي inquiries احنا ان شاء الله هيبقى في feedback form هتتبعت يعني in few minutes. So you can send all your questions through feedback form وإن شاء الله هنرد عليكم من خلالها يعني. عشان بس we're running out of time.
تمام تمام يا سماح، وأنا welcome لأي points، وحتى عايز يبعت لي. شكرا يا أحمد وشكرا لكلكم، ولو في أي حد عنده طبعا أي سؤال أو حد عايز يبعت لي حتى حاجة personally I'm welcome. إن شاء الله خير بإذن الله، بالتوفيق إن شاء الله.
إن شاء الله. Thank you.
شكرا 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 يا ابو شكرا يا جماعه شكرا. السلام عليكم.